on the hedge fund world, and in particular, the guys who make this industry go. Not so easy to make things go these days, so we are lucky to be joined by some of the biggest success stories in the hedge fund and asset management world. Cliff Asness, founder of AQR, one of the largest and most diversified asset managers, which at over $150 billion of AUM, is no small feat. Steve Cohen, founder of Point72, an icon in the hedge fund world, and some would say one of the greatest long-short equity investors of all time. And Neil Chris, founder of Hutch & Hill, a newer and fast-rising multi-strategy platform that has defied the common refrain that it is so difficult for newer funds to scale, and getting more difficult by the day. Welcome, everyone. It's no secret that hedge fund performance has been challenging for the last few years. The industry has come under criticism and a questioning of its value. Are hedge funds worth the fees they charge? Warren Buffett recently answered that question with a resounding no. What say you, Neil Chris?
Steve?
Go ahead, Neil.
Well, so I think it's a good question to ask. Are hedge funds worth the fees? And I think the answer comes down to what are hedge funds delivering? Let's face it, if you go back to the 90s, the origins of hedge funds and before, hedge funds delivered something very special, high returns or very differentiated returns that you could not get elsewhere. And that is what hedge fund investors have been looking for. And I think the problem is, since the crisis, a lot of hedge funds have not been delivering. Returns have been mediocre, too much like the indices, too much like each other. So I think if hedge funds are delivering what they've promised, then they can justify their fees. If not, I think investors are going to look elsewhere.
Cliff, what do you say as someone who runs an asset management firm?
Well, it's an interesting distinction. We do hedge funds, but it's only a part of what we do, so I'm kind of in both worlds. 15, 16 years ago, we wrote a paper called Do Hedge Funds Hedge, where we took the critical side. And of course, we're only looking at indices of all hedge funds. It's not specific. But we were arguing that they're too correlated and fees are too high and there's not a lot of extra return. Maybe not surprising to anyone who knows me. Now that the criticism's all there, I'm kind of taking the other side. I think criticism's fair. Neil's point is right. We should hold feet to the fire. But the benchmark they compare to is simply wrong. Our criticism of hedge funds is they don't hedge enough. They're supposed to be kind of uncorrelated assets, and the indices have been insanely correlated for a long time. Having said that, they're about the hedge fund world, and everybody's different, but the hedge fund world is about, if you give them a dollar, their average exposure is about a third to stocks. It's been a 6-7 year bull market. It doesn't feel like that right now, because it has been about a year since it's been flat, but it's been a 6-7 year bull market. Hedge funds, if you compare to their exposure, have actually had a decent run for 6 to 7 years. They're not supposed to beat the market in a bull market. So I'm a little weird. We're critical, got yelled at by a lot of people 15 years ago. And believe it or not, I was young once. It was scary to be yelled at by people I had heard of. We're now sitting there saying, you know, criticism's fair, hold feet to the fire, but these are at least partially hedged assets. And the comparison against all stocks makes you look really good when the stock market goes down and really bad when it goes up. And it's hurt them in the last 6 or 7 years.
Steve, in February, equity hedge funds did particularly poorly.
Yes.
As too many crowded into the same names on the short side.
Absolutely.
Do you feel that there are too many players and too many assets chasing the same ideas? And if so, how do you outperform in this environment?
Well, that's something actually that I was worried about last year. I actually had a meeting with a management team, and I was talking about how, like, one of my biggest worries is that there's so many players out there trying to do similar strategies, and that, you know, if one of these highly levered players had a rough run and took down risk, would we be collateral damage? And in February, we drew down 8%, which, you know, is for us a lot. And my worst fears were realized. So yeah, I think you know, the business gotten crowded. The strategies aren't that much differentiated. People seem to think they can just go hire talent and it's like magically they're going to earn returns. And the reality is, and they're trying to grow to the point where there's somebody, it's very hard to maximize returns and then maximize assets too. You know, when this business started, guys took pride in the returns that they generated. I mean, guys would make 20, 25, 30%. Now it's about trying to figure out the intersection between the assets under management and what investors would be willing to accept.
That's a good point that I want to ask you about, Neil, which is as assets grow, doesn't the law of large numbers start to apply where it becomes that much more difficult to find ideas at the size that you need to generate the same kind of performance? And if the industry is going to become more consolidated and the big guys get bigger, what does that do to performance?
Well, I mean, I think there's two things. First of all, eventually, everything's going to look like the market index if you get big enough. But to the starting with the crowding and what that means, when you're growing, you're going to have, if you're getting the right ideas and everyone else is getting the right ideas, you're going to be in a certain fraction of trades that are very crowded. And in order to scale, you are, first of all, going to need to have a bigger investment in risk management and other technology and other resources to be able to manage through drawdowns. Steve, you talked about having an 8% drawdown, but I'm sure that I know you have great risk management and you know how to come out of that.
That happened in 4 days.
Right.
And the markets were going up at the time. I mean, it was remarkable.
And that kind of... So who does well in that particular environment and who doesn't has a lot to do with how the people are trained, what the risk management protocol is, and how people deal with the outside, the other end. But in terms of growth, it depends how you grow. The typical question is, if you're growing a book, do you add more resources, invest more in the people and technology to cover more names, cover more asset classes, cover more regions, or do you simply jam more, money into the same names? And if you do the former, I think you grow pretty big and pretty successfully. If you just try to have more and more in the same names, it becomes very difficult.
Do you think that's an argument for the multi-managers?
Absolutely, because multi-managers... So the question is, what happens when a firm goes from 500 million to a billion? Maybe they have 1 PM and 4 analysts, and then at a billion, they have 1 PM, 4 analysts, and 2 IR people. That's not the kind of growth you want to see. You want to see a second PM and more analysts, or you can do the multi-manager type model, where you have more PMs covering truly distinct things.
But I would argue that... our view at Point72 is that talent is really thin. And we probably only accept, or even, we winnow down the funnel down to maybe 2 to 4% of the actual candidates that we might be interested in. And frankly, I mean, I'm blown away by the, the lack of talent. It's not easy to find great people.
My job's not easy, Stu.
No. That's why you get paid the big bucks.
I had no idea if you were going to say you were blown away by the lack of talent or by the amount of talent. I was hanging on to discover if it was optimistic.
You think there's a lot of talent?
No, I live in a very different world. It's not just being an asset manager, but I'm a quant geek. We face capacity and size constraints also. You can't just put more dollars into something. You have a little more control in that you can decide how much, but not total control. Neil's point about multi-manager is interesting, though. One thing, I think you want to set yourself up so you can very easily and consciously decide what to do and what not to do. And I've just written that it's hard to time some strategies, so I'm not going to be a hypocrite and say you should be in and out. But if you do think one part of what you do is much more crowded, you should be in a place that it's pretty easy Mm-hmm. not to do that. That can be hard in an organizational setup. For instance, let's say you do a very narrow set of things. Not many organizations, and I don't claim to be one, can look at and say, take all your money back or we're going to do nothing for a while. If you're a multi-manager, if you're quant, there are disadvantages to all these things, but our models don't get mad if we turn one off.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they don't say anything,
right.
At least.
That is true, but the PMs do.
They usually, their skills are fungible enough.
Oh, that's a separate topic.
So in terms of finding...
And they like that word fungible about them.
They
People
do.
Take that as a great compliment.
They do. I can hire another 10 just like...
I'm in some trouble now.
In terms of finding areas that are not overcrowded, do you guys think that looking to Europe and Asia for pockets of opportunity makes sense, given those markets are arguably 10 years behind the U.S. in terms of the amount of capital pursuing these their investments there, the level of work being done, and the sophistication of investors? Do you think that's a way right now to find areas of alpha?
I think there are a lot of different places in the world where you potentially can find alpha. But that has its own challenges as far as managing offices, managing people far away from the mothership. We do it. Our offices overseas are smaller than our headquarters and main offices in New York and Connecticut. But we do it, and we have found people who are doing... We like people who do a strategy, stick to what they do best, and do it over and over again. But without question, you can go around the world, and there are pockets where it seems like there's more alpha than maybe in the U.S. right now, or less competitive.
Do you think that becomes a barrier to entry for newer funds in that they also need to be global in their approach to investing?
You know, see, here's the thing, and something's happened in this industry where everybody thinks they have to be big. And I would argue, that, especially from the investor side, that I mean, I can remember taking a meeting with a Swiss investor, say, I don't know, 7, 8 years ago. And he kept yelling at me. He goes, "Why are you getting bigger? Why are you getting bigger?" And I just looked at him and said, "Why don't you mind your own business?" You know, but you know, there's that conflict between getting too big and then the issues about managing a larger organization, which is a whole separate issue. And trying to deliver, you know, good risk-adjusted returns.
It just seems to me it's so difficult now for newer funds because for the last few years they've needed to look so institutional. I'd love your perspective on this, Neil. Out of the gate, they had to, in order to attract institutional capital, they needed to show investors that they could deal with managing assets in size. They could deal with regulators. They could deal with the rising costs of compliance. They needed to look like real businesses from the get-go if they wanted to be able to compete. And now we also have the overlay, if this is where things are heading, of big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence. So if I'm a long short equity investor and I want to start a fund, I now also need to find data scientists, data analysts, programmers, in terms of my, and just raises the barriers to entry in terms of the resources that I need. How do I compete if that's where the industry is going?
Can't compete. Not possible. No, seriously, the reality is the hedge fund industry was a couple $100 billion in the mid-1990s, and now it's approximately $3 trillion. So that's a 15-fold increase. During that time, so why did it increase? Because there was a lot of institutional investors who wanted what the hedge funds promised to offer. So those investors want more, and especially after the financial crisis, especially after a period of mediocre returns, notwithstanding what Cliff said, the truth is still the perception is the returns have not lived up to the promise. So now people are demanding more. And yeah, they want better IR, better compliance. They want to make sure top to bottom these institutions are run like businesses, which means you need a professional management staff, professional risk management, and the overlay of resources in investing to be able to produce. Or so what Steve said about recruiting, we agree, the talent level's thin, and no wonder. We're 15 times the assets. There's not 15 times as many good portfolio managers with original ideas who can manage risk well. So that means you have to have recruiters, resources to manage the recruiting, resources to evaluate your internal talent, so on and so forth.
I'm starting to like Ilana's business a lot more.
Steve, I need an intern for the summer.
Yeah, exactly.
Cliff, as returns have come down and people reach for risk, we've seen managers pushing into other products to grow and diversify their revenue streams. We've seen asset managers go into hedge products. We've seen hedge funds develop long-only vehicles, and we've certainly seen both asset managers and hedge funds go into private investing. Some of the biggest VC checks for early-stage private companies were written from the public side. What do you think a manager should consider in thinking about how to diversify?
I think this is just common sense, but it's often not applied. Take two of your examples, long only and hedge funds versus going into privates. And I'll give you our experience. We've really done nothing. I'm trying to make, when I say nothing, I want to be really zero on the private side. We have done both hedge funds and beat the benchmark traditional long only since minute one 20 years ago. Because again, my world's a little bit different. But a pure model-based approach, and it has its disadvantages, this is an advantage. If you like A and don't like B, you own more of A and less of B, and you're an institutional product. You will long A and short B, and you're a hedge fund. We use the same models. It's never been different. We've always been the same. If, on the other hand, your skill, you're a great stock picker, and you suddenly, but you've never shorted anything. You're an active manager. You've been running a mutual fund forever. It's a different situation. You've shown no skill at that. You don't suddenly get good at that. I would imagine, I hope my clients would have a big pushback if I said, we're going to take a quarter of the assets and put it into private vehicles. Suddenly, I am Shark Tank. And I'm very, very good at that, which would be a lot of my kids would enjoy if I was on Shark Tank, but my clients would not. So I think it is common sense, but expansion in something that you have a very logical, this applies to this, should be fine. It has its challenges. It's a bigger management challenge, to Steve's point, but it's logical. It makes sense. When you go to your clients and say, we got a whole brand new skill set, I don't think anything should be given the back of the hand and never listened to, but they should be a lot more cynical about that.
And yet we've seen a lot of different entities develop into things that they hadn't done before.
Are you trying to get me to make fun of someone specifically?
No.
Because I'll do it. I'm kidding.
Well, we're all dying to find out who.
No, I have no idea. I'm bluffing.
I want to come at this question of investor sentiment by sharing a couple of data points about hedge funds. The first is that in this past quarter, was the worst net withdrawal period for hedge funds since the end of the financial crisis. The second data point is that this past February, hedge funds in total raised $4.4 billion, which is interesting given in every other February from 2010 to 2015, hedge funds raised an average of $23 billion. So that's a 6x drop. The other thing that makes that last data point particularly interesting is that February, since the crisis, has accounted for 54% of the amount that hedge funds have raised in any given year. Neil, do you think that this is a secular shift in investor sentiment? Is the industry contracting and restructuring, or is this just a 2016 blip?
I definitely don't think it's just a 2016 blip, and I don't think that investors simply didn't like the returns and started to make net withdrawals. I think that there is a confluence of a kind of feeling that enough is enough, that the returns have been poor. Now, the truth is, returns have been poor relative to indices that have done very well, to Cliff's point. And it's been a very difficult market to beat the indices. But nevertheless, the feeling is, when so many funds are so correlated to one another and the returns aren't there, and you look at the fees, something's got to give. And there's alternatives, liquid alts and other things, where people say, maybe we don't need this. So I think what's going to happen is there's going to be more demand on hedge funds to either significantly outperform the indices or provide something that truly hedges, that's truly uncorrelated to the markets, or a combination of both. So I do think we're heading down that road.
Also, you can't fully separate it. Look at the traditional active management industry. No hedge funds, just that's shrunk a lot. Indices have been, these are very similar effects. And when I say it's not been a disaster that people think, I'll stand by that, but it has flattened out. Even quote, properly done. If you kind of take the indices, which are deeply flawed, I don't report. Do you report to the indices?
You mean like, do we say like
Credit Suisse or the hedge fund research? Are you in the indices?
Because we did it way back, and you can't.
I don't think we've ever done it. Really, do you do it? I can't find many people who are actually in the indices that I use to analyze.
They don't have family.
you get it.
I don't know what you're talking about.
But if you take the indices and compare to what I argue is proper, the one-third of the market, and by the way, they're not supposed to make one-third of the market average. They're supposed to add over that. Used to look like this using those indices, and it's flattened out for 3 or 4 years.
Yep.
Now, we know in investing, there's one of two things that are very competing forces. One is people overreact to 3 to 5 year performance. I believe that. So if this is just a bad period, this reaction is overdone. On the other hand, capitalism works. It attracts too many assets. Money comes in, returns go down.
I agree. Yep.
And differentiating between those two is hard, but it's not occurring just in hedge funds. It's occurring across active management. What we did quite a while ago is we divided what we do into what we think is some form of true alpha and what we think is more exposure to factors. We've charged a lot less for one than the other. So when you nicely quote our size, it's big, but it's not quite as big as it sounds because it's stratified. So we've tried to adjust for the new world. But part of this is, I think, media frenzy, and I'll stick by that. And I think I was very early in criticizing hedge funds, so taking the other side now is a bit of a flip for me, but it's directional. Its media is overdone, but it's directionally right. It has been weaker for a while, and I expect better than the last 3 to 5 years, but lower than history. It's a fairly safe forecast.
Okay.
I think.
Well, let me just say one thing, because so we've done research at Hutch and Hill, and one thing I can tell you is, since the crisis, drawdowns in equity markets have recovered incredibly quickly, so versus pre-crisis. So what I mean is, if there's a 4% drawdown, how long does it take to get back to where you were? In this period, it's been unprecedented. Whereas pre-crisis, it took over 2 months for big drawdowns to recover, and much, much more in certain cases. Post-crisis, it's been less than 20 days. So what happens is that really favors passive management versus active management, because by the time you react and you see this violent drawdown, it looks like the world's ending, an active manager reacts, and then the market's back to where it was, and all of a sudden, they're behind. That is a very tough market for many active managers to beat the indices. I believe, though, that the what's going on is that, or we believe, is that monetary policy and faith in monetary authorities' ability to stabilize markets has played a huge role in this. And eventually, that's going to give way, one way or another, to markets that are much easier for active managers to beat the indices. And I think then some of this underperformance will dissipate.
You know, some of this performance has been related to the fact that people are looking for yield. And so in the big indices, obviously, they're yielding something as opposed to bonds that are yielding nothing.
Absolutely.
And so there's sort of a bias there. And you can say, well, hedge funds should be able to play that. It's really not the names they traffic in, the General Electrics. And we usually make our money in more esoteric situations. And that's been like a one-way train. I think Neil's right. It has to do with policymakers. Every time the market dips, they come rushing right in with some support measures. And so you don't get the normal shakeout and opportunity and something maybe people can spend time analyzing stocks. You get these Vs that just, run right back up.
So, but in the meantime, Steve, let's say I'm an investor looking to allocate. And
yes.
I get the HSBC report every week, like everyone else, and all other sorts of performance metrics. And I'm looking at funds by strategy. And the performance and the revenue streams look remarkably similar. I mean, there's not that much, differentiation.
Yes.
And they're relatively unimpressive. How do I figure out which boat to jump into to sort of get me to the other side? If I'm going to allocate, what are the things I should be looking for? Because the top line isn't telling me much.
It's a tough question because there are a lot of smart people in this business and they run, pretty good organizations. And yet the performance hasn't been what I think they would have hoped it to be. And I think it's just a function of, I think it's a function of a couple things. We're at the end of a bull market. Multiples are very high. So you know, you don't really have that same wind at your back where everything levitates up. And I'm not talking about just being long. I'm just saying that in general, money's flowing into the markets. Here, I call it the big bathtub where money just washes over here, then washes over here, and then comes back the other way. And so it actually requires more timing skills. And you know, our data in our firm says that most of our people in the firm are not very good market timers. They're very good stock pickers, but they're not great market timers.
Do you guys think fees get affected?
Yes.
Okay.
They're going way up.
what's the question?
Whether fees get affected. He said they're going way up.
Well, 20% of nothing, still nothing.
Well, yeah, the performance fees nicely take care of themselves. But we've thought for a long time that some in the industry, and I'm not talking about us, there's some people worth very outsized fees, but on average, we thought fees were too high. So some of this is actually investor-friendly long-term. The same skilled managers, whatever you think their skill might be at a lower fee, is pretty much about the only thing that really works. I like to do the opposite. A quote I like, which I don't know who I'm quoting here, but there is no investment process so good that there's not a fee high enough to make it bad. Fees generally coming down. For a long time, we thought hedge fund fees were too high, partly because some of what goes on in hedge funds are known strategies, trend-following strategies, carry strategies, very diversified arbitrage strategies that are doing everything someone else does. Those can be very good strategies, but they're about exposure. They're not about uniqueness, and they should be offered at a different fee. I remember pre-crisis, pre-GFC, being asked in something that looks something like this, you know, if you believe that, what's going to make that world happen? And I actually said something that turned out to be dramatically wrong. I said, well, a really bad crisis where hedge funds suffered. Maybe the world would jolt. Then we had that, and it didn't happen. I think it's happening now with a 6-7 year delay. I think no matter what, even if I can defend it, and even if I could say against the right benchmark, it doesn't look as bad, that's kind of damning with faint praise. I still stand by the original that as an industry, the fees were too high. So this is not all bad news.
Do you think they just come down, let's say, from 2 and 20 to, I don't know, 1.5 and 18? Or is it that as investors are now savvier and more sophisticated, they perhaps move to more creative structures like just paying on alpha? Or maybe if it's a strategy that tends to have lumpy returns, they say, okay, we get it. So we'll pay on the net returns over 2 to 3 years.
I think those would all be, at least those two ideas, would both be interesting and good. The world has not been very open to these. We've proposed on and off for years a performance fee. It's a little bizarre, you have to bear with me, where you got paid a higher share if it was a lower correlation return stream and a smaller share if it was a very correlated return stream. In the short term, there's a lot of noise to that because even correlations could be somewhat random. But if someone sticks with you in the long term, they should pay more for returns that they can't get elsewhere. Never actually gotten anyone interested in that.
It is amazing that investors are not being the more demanding. You know, when I take a look at it, you know, just from my family office. I mean, it's actually amazing to me, you know, because you would think that at some point, well, on the other side is you would think managers, they have a choice of being in business or not being in business. If it means cutting their fees, you know, they'll do what they have to do to stay in business.
But that's an excellent point. I don't understand this at all, but it seems very discreet. Investors seem to either leave and say, we're going to cut our hedge fund allocation. Right. There's a big meeting. There's a newspaper story. They don't seem to come and even big investors that probably have some market power and say, how about you guys all do this at less? And I think it would be a very healthy development if they did that more.
Well, and, you know, typical pension funds, endowments tend to be trend followers as opposed to forward thinking. And so, you know, that's the way, listen, I've been on boards, I've seen it in action. But that's kind of the way it is, you know. But I think, listen, this is industry's now been around in a real way for 25, 30 years. And the way I describe it is excess profits get competed away in one way or another. If margins are too high in a business, More people are going to enter the business and drive it down. It hasn't happened yet, and it's starting to happen now. It'll probably continue to happen. Whatever the reasons are, lack of returns, investor resistance, whatever it is. But that, you know, that's sort of a normal industry, in any industry, cycle.
I think that one thing that is likely to happen is we're going to see more investors asking, what are my fees paying for? So there's been sort of a, one-size-fits-all approach to fees, 2 and 20. Now there's some fees that are higher at this event, obviously. But the point is, 2 and 20, whether the fund's management company costs 30 basis points to run or 200 basis points to run. And the point is, some funds with a 2 and 20 structure are spending that money on all kinds of resources, people, infrastructure, technology and data to produce alpha, and others aren't. And I think investors are going to start to say, what are your management company margins? What are you doing with these fees to generate alpha? And that's one approach that I think would make sense. If somebody has a huge quant infrastructure, huge data infrastructure that's being used to spend money, the money's being used on resources that are generating alpha and they're producing, I think those fees will be tolerated. I think if somebody is essentially just creating very fat margins for their business and the same thing is available elsewhere, I think it'll be tougher.
Okay, I'm going to shift gears and talk technology. Ready for the first question?
Fire away.
Okay. As fundamental investing becomes more quantitative and data-driven, and computers are able to process large quantities of information, capture every credit card transaction, every time a doctor writes a prescription, and what that might say about a drug company and its earnings, and make the conclusion and put on the trade in a fraction of the time it takes a human to do it, are we going to even need humans?
You're asking someone who doesn't really need humans now.
Okay, so precisely
there are some other people in the office that are doing something. I think the way, my favorite way to separate the quantitative world from the, I have no good word for the opposite of quantitative, by the way.
It's fundamental?
We look at fundamentals too in models. Qualitative is a little too insulting to non-quants. What is it? They just get an aura of I don't know, but quants and non-quants, I think of very generally, quant is most applicable when you can make tons of decisions and diversify across them. I don't like the moral aspect of this analogy, but you're a house in a casino, right? A house in a casino doesn't want one blackjack table. They want many blackjack tables. You want, and again, please, no moral analogy. Your favorite thing is seven busloads of grandmothers with quarters. Because you have the odds in your favor and they just keep playing. One guy flies in and wants to bet millions of dollars, you don't have a very big edge. You're probably going to win. The odds are on your side, but there's a lot of fear there. I always think of less quantitative approaches, judgmental, if you will, as being more suited to a more concentrated portfolio. I am a fan of computers and quantitative techniques. I can't imagine ever getting to the point where any pattern of data would leave me comfortable without a person with a very narrow portfolio. I can't imagine that, even though it's not what I do. I can't imagine that if a person knows that business in and out. It's odd you have me defending taking the fundamental side, but I have trouble seeing computers completely replace that.
Well, didn't a computer recently defeat the world champion at Go, and I thought 4-1, I think. 4-1. And I thought that was interesting because as opposed to chess, where Deep Blue beat Kasparov back in 97, I think, right. Chess has, does not have unlimited strategies. There may be millions of strategies, but you can program the computer. Go has infinite strategies. So the reality is this computer had to be taught to think for itself. It had to be taught to tease out the patterns, understand what's important in large pools of information, and make the next move. Isn't that what you do? Isn't that what a PM does?
What I do, like the computer?
No, like
computer's gonna be better.
In terms of it thinking like a human, out.
The computers are here. That's what quant does. And I was just up in Silicon Valley. I came down, I was up there Thursday and Friday. Met with some deep learning companies, AI companies, And it's coming, but it's not there yet. You know, one of the big things now is deep learning. I would say the thing they can do really well is recognize images and learn from images, which is great in radiology and medicine, stuff like that. So, you know, these predictions are impossible to call, but it's going to be a while before humans are... And what we actually think is going to happen is that the way it's going to affect this industry is you're going to see tasks being automated, but ultimately there'll be a human adding that value at the top to, you know, so it'll be a combination effort.
The scary thing about what happened with Lee Sedol, who was the world champion in Go, being defeated by Google's DeepMind AlphaGo product 4-1, was that not too long before that happened, people were saying that no computer would beat the world Go champion for several decades. So I agree with Steve with a big asterisk. And the asterisk is that the advances have been surprising in this field, and they've been able to make leaps and bounds that nobody expected. And I do think it's coming, and I think what you're going to see is something that's sort of different than what Cliff said about quant. So I agree, the way quant worked, the statistical arbitrage was the idea. It wasn't really arbitrage, but it was sort of like you had a good shot if you made enough trades all at once, right? So the idea was you found some kind of pattern that applied to a huge cross-section of stocks. Now there's all kinds of data out there that might apply to only a few stocks. So, you know, they might only apply to 20, 30, 50 stocks, you know, like the credit card data you talked about. And people will be able to acquire that data cheaply enough and use tools that are general enough.
But here's the thing, you know, I mean, it's interesting when you speak to people who are actually generating the data, companies in all spaces, they'll tell you that they really don't think that monetizing that data is going to work. And the reason is that once data gets sold in bulk to a number of players, it becomes commoditized.
Yep.
And it's not worth as much. So people are buying for a defensive just to know maybe, but they can't... It's not really going to add a lot of alpha to... So I think there's a little bit of a tension there as far as... Because anything that everybody sees at the same time is going to be commoditized.
Yeah, I agree. It's a paradox. What's going to happen is the stuff is going to quickly get arbed away because everyone's going to have it. There's places that sell credit card data, and now it's becoming everyone has to have it. But that, maybe... I'd be curious what you think.
Yeah.
I think it's going to raise the entry cost of doing the business because even though it doesn't add value, paradoxically... It will subtract value if you don't have it.
Well, the irony is if, you know, the companies are selling the data, if people find it commoditized, they're going to pay very much for it.
Yeah, well,
and therefore, they can, you know, most people could afford it. So there's this...
They're not developing it in-house.
I'm going to take the...
Well, you know, people... But even if I were, you know, and we are developing in-house, mm-hmm. if we're looking at similar data sets, then it really comes down to... You're betting on your ability to sift out data that no one else can. There's a lot of smart people in this world. You have to assume that they understand. These are techniques that are well understood. So unless you're getting exclusive data sets, you know, or have figured out ways to look at data completely unique, you know, I think ultimately, you know, I think there's going to be limited value to that data.
I'm going to take the other side slightly in two ways. One, I don't think you have to compete on every front. It is not the case that if you and Steve fully arbitrage away the credit card data, I have to do it too. You have made that market efficient. You've made money for yourselves, which is nice. But I'm not really at risk at this point. It's in the price. A little bit's in your pocket,
right?
But it's in the price. Another way I think this is interesting, where I think there will still be an edge, and I'm just starting to think about this, but you talked about scale and how big you have to be. One advantage to scale, and there are disadvantages to scale, but one advantage is the ability to monetize fairly low risk adjusted return additions. If you're an expert in a very narrow thing that has a very small edge, that's very hard to make a business out of a very small edge.
But if you have a small edge, how much capital can you put behind it where all of a sudden, you know, the large numbers apply?
Well. I was making up a small edge that could be fairly scaled. But imagine you could do that.
Okay.
It's not very useful or pleasant way to live your life, and it's very hard to get investor confidence in it. If you are adding that to a diversified process where you're doing many other things, be they quantitative or less, or not less, you're quantitative. What the hell do I call you?
I don't know. Call me
quant
Steve.
Whether you're giving it to quants or Steve or Neil, if they're adding it to something they're doing in many other things, a small edge can be monetized by that group. It's very, very hard to run narrower. And if the edge on everything comes down, you will, to some extent, need to do more things, and there'll be some organizations that can do many things.
Maybe it makes sense, and incremental, alphas along the way, and maybe it adds up to something. That's reasonable.
Steve, earlier you talked about how scarce great talent is.
Yes.
Okay. So many people...
Except for my firm does all great talent.
And except when I show them to you.
Right. Oh, well, that's a given.
Okay, just checking.
Right.
So this is a question really for the two of you, but Cliff would love your perspective if you'd like to share anything.
She doesn't want my perspective.
I do. Okay, so there are people you hire mm-hmm. who have never run a portfolio, have never run in the way that a multi-manager tends to like to run, which is less correlated to the market, more diversified, more velocity, less concentrated, and lower volatility. Mm-hmm. How do you figure out, when you meet people, who has the chops to do this?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's two ways to do it. You can hire from people from the outside, and a lot of firms do that. We prefer to develop people, and you get to know them, and they rise through the ranks, and we believe that, we're going to provide as many teaching resources as we can to, make these people, whether they're analysts or, budding PMs, better investors. So, when we look at our data, 80% of our PMs that come through the ranks come through internally, and only 20% from the outside. And we actually believe in that strongly, and that's sort of a mantra in our firm.
Yeah.
I think what Steve's doing is great. I think it's actually more challenging in a way. We've actually gravitated towards, trying to hire people who are at kind of the penultimate stage of their career, where they've done very well and demonstrated that they have trading talent, whether it be quantitative or fundamental. And then we try to get them when they're ready to make a significant shift in their career and they want something completely different. And I think that, whether you're doing it internally and developing people or whether you're bringing people from the outside, you have to ask a lot of tough questions about whether someone is adaptable, someone is able to make very difficult decisions, and also is able to scale. So at the end of the day, we look at portfolio managers as people who are making decisions under time pressure and under incomplete information. They don't have all the information and they don't have enough time to get it. They have to decide what to look at, and whether that's a quant who's saying what signals do I research and when do I have enough information to make a decision, or whether it's a fundamental analyst, portfolio manager. But we're looking for good decision makers. And then in our case, versus developing them, we're trying to look for someone who has a track record who's actually been out there and has demonstrated that they can make those good decisions.
People have talked a lot about the barriers to entry going up, be it because of technology or other things. Do you see this, Cliff, as being good for the stakes in seeding business? Because now it becomes maybe even more important to have a partner to fund an enterprise. One statistic, which I think is interesting, is of the 8,000 hedge funds typically tracked, 67% manage less than $250 million.
Where do you get these numbers? You have numbers on everything.
I've got numbers on everything.
Well, you make a small...
You've got numbers on everything.
How you make a small fortune, you start with a large one. So maybe they start with
The CD and staking business isn't my business, certainly, but I do think barriers to entry have gone way up. From the strategies getting squeezed, and one version of when I say
being big and having many strategies means you can accept a newer strategy at a lower bound. Also makes it much harder to get started, right? It's much harder to get started with 50 strategies than it is to be an expert in one. You mentioned this very briefly, but I think it is non-trivial, the compliance and regulatory costs. I mean, I'll whine about this politically. I'll sit there and go, it's probably net good. You know, a lot of the, not good for the world, good for existing players. Mm-hmm. This is terrible. It sounds like cronyism. I don't want it. But when you raise a barrier on new people, existing successful businesses get protected in some way. So I think the bottom line answer is going to be, yeah, it's going to be harder for someone to start from scratch, and they're going to need more help.
Makes sense. Okay, so now I'm going to shift to more personal questions.
Wait, you didn't tell me you were going to do
that. I'm going to do that. But Steve, I'm not going to put you on the spot. I'm just going to ask them, and whoever wants to answer will answer. But that being said, I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm glad I had a choice.
So let's go back in time. What were your earliest influences?
Sure.
Got you even thinking about this business?
You know, I had two people in my life that used to always talk about stocks. One was my grandmother, who used to talk about American Home Products. And, you know, I used to look and...
Your grandmother?
My grandmother.
That's awesome.
And then there was another lady, an African-American lady, who used to take care of us when my parents went on vacation. And she used to talk about her stocks. And I noticed, like, every 6 months she'd come back and it would go up 50%, maybe double. And so I go, this is pretty interesting. I don't know what's going on. And so my dad used to bring the Post home every day, and you'd read the sports, and then the financial pages are right behind it. And so that's where it started. And then I started hanging out in brokerage firms when I was 14 and started looking at the tape then. And I can remember going to college and, you know, missing a lot of classes, but hanging out in brokerage firms there and just refining my skills. And, you know, I was doing it my own way. And that was what it was pattern recognition. And you know, I didn't know it then, but that's what I was doing. And, you know, and it was working for me, so I kept doing it.
Wasn't there something about you arbitraging candy when you were a kid?
Well, you know, if you bought bulk candy, you know, and then split them up, you know, you could end up, we used to sell... driveway in my house, that was my first form of arbitrage. And so I said, this works.
Cool. Anyone want to share anything else in terms of
I had absolutely no interest in stocks as a child.
Okay.
I had an interest in candy. For me, I was an undergrad in engineering. I was a computer engineer. I like to keep this from anyone on the tech side at work, because they will wonder why a guy with a degree in computer engineering is screaming that he can't get Helvetica font. Because, you know, Fortran is not so applicable anymore. But I was a degree in engineering. I had always intended to be an engineer and then go to law school. And my dad was a lawyer, two uncles were lawyers all over the family. And it was my father who said something and very, very basic. And I apologize if there are any lawyers in the room, but you know this is true. He said, you're very mathematical and you're into all this stuff. I think more people can be lawyers than can do that, so you should do that. And I just kind of listened to him. I wish I had a deeper story.
It's a lucky miss, Cliff.
I literally had applied for the LSATs, mm-hmm. and I switched it to the GMATs.
Greatest strength, greatest weakness, and how that has influenced how you invest and or built your organization.
Okay.
I'm looking at you, but you don't have to answer.
No, sure. Greatest strength. I don't know. I'll tell you, in terms of the business, as we know, especially in the kind of multi-manager, recruiting is a very big part of the game. And you have to be able to identify people and get them to join your organization. And I was always very good at recruiting. And I just liked people. And you know, I like to kind of organize people in my life and get them to do what I was doing from a very early age. So that's a strength that I think helps in the multi-manager world. As a weakness, I always admired Steve's trading ability, and I would never be a good portfolio manager. I would sort of, it's just not something that I could do. But what it's allowed me to do in the business is hire portfolio managers and leave them alone, because they say, well, I'm so confident that I wouldn't be able to sort of go in there and sort of fix anything, not directly, maybe indirectly, and helping them, develop, but not directly. So it's made me sort of a good manager because I'm very hands off.
It's clearly not about the money for any of you anymore, and I would argue it was probably never about the money. What inspires each of you?
I saw my father retire. Great guy, vital guy, and then he retired, and he wasn't doing anything, And I just looked at that, and that's why, I just get restless, and that's why I was up in Silicon Valley. That's why I'm always trying to do new things, because and the best ideas come out of the firm, and so if you listen closely, and if you're supportive, and if you're willing to fail, I mean, not every idea is going to work, and if you allow people to fail and say, listen, and you might even learn something in the failing, I think that's a good strategy. And I think if you're not innovating, you're dying. If you're stagnating. And people know it in the firm. They want to be at an exciting place where they can learn new things. And that makes sense. And so that's what we try to do. We're always thinking about new ways to attack the problems we deal with on a daily basis.
Okay, so we have time for one last question, which I can't not ask. The election is just a few months away. Thoughts? Anything you want to share, candidates that you might support, candidates you wouldn't short, how things might get affected?
# never any of them.
Right.
That's clear.
I think I'm with a tremendous amount of the country and just being deeply disappointed with what are the likely two choices.
Mm-hmm. Out of 315 million?
We seem to have a lot of choices at one point, and they seem to narrow. And again, I'm sure this is a contentious subject. People are going to have different opinions, but I am personally disappointed with the two who look to be remain standing. Mm-hmm. I think I'm flipping a coin.
I think the world's watching. I think people are concerned around the world. We get asked by non-U.S. investors all the time. One investor actually asked me, I was shocked, who I was voting for. I said, really? Do I have to answer this? What's the protocol? But I never heard such a thing. And I think people are worried. So from my point of view, I think there's going to be more and more anxiety. And people will be very relieved, whoever gets elected, that it's behind us.
Yeah, I'm a little confused. I'm not sure what to do. And I'm hoping that as the campaign goes on, it maybe reveals itself in one direction or another. I just don't know what to do. This is unusual, what's going on here, obviously. But it's funny. The world continues to change, and what we thought was true may not be true. And so you got to keep your... You gotta be willing to listen to what's going on and try to figure it out, because ultimately things tend to reveal themselves over time.
At least they have a bipartisan hate of hedge funds.
Oh yes.
Doesn't matter in the end.
In that narrow way, I don't think it matters very much.
Right.
Yeah.
That was good.
Thank you all for being here, and let's give a big hand to our terrific panelists.